Hello, my name is Molly White. I grew up in Iowa, and I went to Iowa State to get my aerospace engineering undergraduate degree. And during my undergraduate experience, I came down to Johnson Space Center to have a co-op, and I worked several co-op tours down here. And once I finally graduated, they offered me a full-time job to work down at Johnson Space Center here in Houston, Texas. And I came down here to work on the current program that I work on, which is Orion. I work Orion Aerothermodynamics, and what that is we're concerned with the heating rates to the exterior of the vehicle. We want to make sure that the crew is protected from the high temperatures that are around the capsule as it re-enters to the atmosphere. Orion is significantly different from any vehicle we've ever flown before. For instance, Orion is going to be re-entering at over 25,000 miles per hour, whereas the space shuttle entered at only 17,000 miles per hour. That's a significant difference in speed, which translates into an even more difference in kinetic energy. And that kinetic energy is what we have to dissipate in order to land our vehicle. So this paper right here that we have taped together into a cone is the actual shape of the Apollo vehicle. And on the drawing here, you can see that the different features on Apollo are called out, such as the window, a leg tower, and we also have the instrumentation where they took flight measurements. Some of them are circled here in red, but they're called out all around the vehicle. And so you can see that Apollo was a much different shape from Orion in the fact that this cone angle is at 33 degrees, and we have a full cone with a tip on it. For Orion, we're a truncated cone, and we are angled at 30 degrees. So this 30 degree back shell angle compared to 33 degrees back shell angle changes our heating significantly. Orion overall will be hotter on this entire conical section compared to Apollo. Also, having this truncated cone compared to Apollo changes how our flow field comes around the vehicle. And so that will change different components and different heating. The reason that we use a combination of both our computational predictions, our wind tunnel testing, and our flight testing is because each one of those three has its own pros and cons. Flight testing is obviously ideal because you're flying the real vehicle through its actual environments and taking measurements on it and making sure that it performs as it should. However, flight testing is extremely expensive and costly and takes a long amount of time. So to get away from flight testing, we use both our computational predictions and our wind tunnel testing. Both of these are a lot faster to do and a lot cheaper. Our computational predictions are the fastest because we can just do those on our computers here in our offices. But obviously those are taking models and theories into them, and we need to make sure that those are validated and that they accurately represent reality. So to do that, we compare to wind tunnel test data. And wind tunnel test data gives us a scaled size vehicle in a simulated environment that then we can compare our computational tools to validate them. We can't simulate all of our flight conditions in our wind tunnels, and so that's why it's still necessary to have that last component of flight testing. But until we get to that phase, we can do our computational predictions and our wind tunnel testing in our design phases of our vehicle.